is the sound of the Savior's robe as he walks into the room where people pray, where we hear praises he hears.
Baptisms, and that's a reason to celebrate. That's right. Come on, so we get to hear their stories. Watch them now. You can take a seat.
I'm Ferris Moody, and I'm being joined today by Kathleen Natola. Kathleen, why don't you share with us the events that got us to this point today? The events that happened in your life that got us to this point.
Hello, everyone, and I apologize, but I'm emotional, and I'm going to read what I wrote.
It's okay.
It's all right. You can't even see it. Okay, here. I grew up in a Catholic household.
It's okay.
with loving parents, a brother 3 years younger, and a sister. My sister's 2 years older, and she's was and is like a second mother to me. I grew up with the knowledge of God. But I didn't have a relationship with him as a young child. I was molested by someone close to my family. And became angry with God. I began acting out in rebellious ways, hating myself. My insecurities, not trusting anyone. I'm sorry. I realized that I was hurting my family, and yet was powerless. Mm-hmm. In high school, I started drinking and taking drugs. I married at 21, thinking my husband would be my savior, who would rescue me, would save me. Instead, my drinking and drug increased. Mm-hmm. Eventually, I came to the end of myself and called out to God that I couldn't take it anymore, mm-hmm. and attempted suicide. Expecting to die, I failed and entered into a rehab program. 10 days later, I encountered the love of Christ, but not the true knowledge of Christ, which led me to a hunger for God's word. Mm-hmm. I then became convinced and convicted that I was a sinner, that no one seeks after God, that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, of the only perfect, holy God. Mm-hmm. In today's world, when someone doesn't agree with us, we're told that it's because there is no absolute truth. That no matter how hard we try to convince ourselves that we are made, that we have made God in our own image, mm-hmm. the truth is we deserve death, mm-hmm. eternal separation from God.
Yeah.
But God offers us a priceless gift of eternal life, mm-hmm. in His Son, Jesus Christ. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us.
Yeah. Amen.
But when we repent, agreeing with God that we are all sinners, mm-hmm. in need of a Savior, yeah. if we turn to Jesus, there is no condemnation, and that nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ. Jesus. When we confess with our mouth Jesus is Lord, believe in our heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, we will be saved. For with our heart we believe and are justified, and with our mouth we confess and are saved. Even though Jesus was rejected by his own people, mm-hmm. God's word says to all who receive him, who believe in his name, he gave the right to become a child of God, born again, not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but by the Holy Spirit of God.
Yeah.
I started attending Harvest 20 years ago and have yet to be baptized because of my fear of being in front of people. I've spent way too much time searching the scriptures to convince myself why I don't need to be baptized. I finally come to realize I needed to step out of my comfort zone and be obedient to the Lord.
All right, and we're gonna do that right now, right? Yeah. So, awesome story, right? Evidence of God's power to fill a void in our life that only He can, right? So it is my honor now to baptize you, but I first want to ask you, why would you like to be baptized today?
I want to be baptized because I love my Lord Jesus, and I want to be obedient to Him. And He was baptized in obedience to His Father.
Yeah.
And I want to be identified with Him.
All right. Well, let's do that. Can I take your glasses?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
Kathleen, here, turn this way. It is by your profession of faith. Here, hold on. That is my honor to baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Michael, come on down. Now we have Michael Belize joining us today. Michael, tell us, share with us the events that led to this day today.
So growing up, I was always angry.
Uh-huh.
I grew up very spiteful because when I was younger, I grew up in a Catholic home, but my parents, they were getting a divorce and everything was just in spite of God. I would do everything in spite of God. And it was just a mess. But then when my grandfather died, my grandfather was like my best friend. It made me want to stop being angry with the Lord and starting to seek the Lord. He was a believer. And through that, I would find myself going to the cemetery and I would just be praying to God. And I would find Him answering my prayers. And even the ones that He didn't answer were just down the road. I would be thanking Him later. And then we would start, me and my girlfriend, we would start going to church. We eventually found Harvest. We got linked into a small group. And ever since I came here and got to know the Lord more, it's been a process of just finding Christ's work in my life.
Amen.
And now I'm not angry. I'm not spiteful. I do things for God. I don't do things in spite of God. I do things for Christ.
Amen.
And not in spite of Christ. And basically it.
All right, all right. So, and why would you like to be baptized today?
I want to publicly proclaim my faith in Jesus Christ.
All right, let's do it.
All right,
It is by your profession of faith, Michael, that I now baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
One more step. There we go. And this is Olivia. How you doing, Olivia?
Good.
Good. Olivia, I would like to ask you, when was it that you trusted Jesus as your Savior?
I've always grown up in a Christian family, and my parents would talk about Christ and make it known that they were Christians. And one day when my mom was talking about Christ, I decided that I wanted to accept Him. And she was like, okay, you know, just tell me when you're ready. And I was like, I'm ready now. And then she's like, you can do it before bedtime, whenever you want. Like, I want to do it right now. So I sat on her lap and we prayed together.
Awesome. Now, Olivia, did you understand even then, like, I'm a sinner, I need a Savior, and Jesus is my only hope, is that right? Good. What's He been doing in your life since then?
After I accepted Him, I felt like even if my family's not around, I can always have someone by my side and to talk to.
Amen. And why, this is a big day for you. This is not Mom and Dad's faith, this is Olivia's faith, right? Why do you want to get baptized now?
I want to get baptized because the Bible says to get baptized, and I want to obey Christ's word.
I think that's as clear as it can be. Olivia, because of your profession of faith in Jesus as your Savior, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. I am so glad you've joined us today. My name is Ramirez Moody, and I serve as the associate pastor of our Young Adults and Compassion Ministries at our Rolling Meadows campus. We'd love to know where you're watching from today. Let us know in the chat or the comments. And if this is your first time with us today, I want to give you a special welcome. No matter where you're joining us from today, we are so glad that you're here. Whether you're new or you come every week, we want to invite you to check in. You could do that on this page through the link in the comments or on the Harvest Bible Chapel app. We'd love to know you're here today and how we could be praying for you this week. Today we start a new four-week series through the Old Testament book of Ruth called Finding Hope in a Disappointing World with Dr. Michael Rydelnik. Longtime friend of Harvest Bible Chapel, Dr. Michael Rydelnik is the professor of Jewish Studies and Bible at Moody Bible Institute. And he's the host and Bible teacher on Open Line with Dr. Michael Rydelnik on Moody Bible Radio. Dr. Rydelnik is the co-editor of the Moody Bible Commentary, along with our very own Dr. Mike Van Lanningham. I want to encourage you to grab your Bible and turn to the book of Ruth as we prepare to study God's Word together. Right now, let me read the Word of God over us in Psalms chapter 17. And it says, I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your wonders of old. I will ponder all of your work and meditate on your mighty deeds. Your way, O God, is holy. What God is great like our God? You are the God who works wonders. You have made known your might amongst the people. I love God's word. Ladies, this announcement's for you. On Friday night, March 5th, and Saturday, March 6th, you are invited to the Harvest Women's Conference. The theme of this year is God over all. One of our keynote speakers is Amy Orr Ewing. She serves as the president of the Oxford Center for Christian Apologetics. Amy is a best-selling author and speaker who has taught on faith, culture, and theology all over the world over the last 20 years. The conference will take place in person at the Rolling Meadows and Elgin campuses, as well as online. We're inviting all women to attend. Register today at harvestnow.info. Well, Harvest, you know that there are several ways that you can give. You can give online or on this page. You can also hold your camera up to the QR code on this screen, and it will take you directly to the giving page on our Harvest website. You can give through the Harvest Bible Chapel app, through a text, or by mailing your gifts to the Rolling Meadows campus. God's word says in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 and 7, the point is this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his own heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. May God help us to be bountiful, cheerful givers for His glory. As we continue to worship, will you join me in prayer? Lord, we just thank you for another opportunity to worship you together today. And even though we are separated, we just ask that you be in our midst today. Your word says that you inhabit our praises. So God, we pray that that will be true for everyone online attending our services today. And God, above all else, we just want your name known and we want your glory to flow in our lives. And so we ask these things in Jesus' name, amen.
We're going to take the next 10 minutes and we're just going to magnify the Lord. We're going to worship God. We do this every single week. Every week we turn our affections to God every Sunday morning as we sing. But every time He has something fresh for us. Love that we're going to be opening up God's Word as a church and talking about hope in a disappointing world. The world can be so dark around us, right? I feel like, at least for me, I saw that so much this past year, more than I ever had before. But I'm thankful that my God is the light of the world.
My mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see His wounds, His hands, His feet. My Savior rode that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears. in robes of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Of God. It's so good to turn our affections to Jesus. God, would you take away anything, any obstacle, any anxiety, any hindrance that would cause our hearts to be distracted from what you want to do in us today? Holy Spirit, would you move in power? Would you receive this worship? We give you all the glory and the honor. It's in your precious name that we pray and sing. Amen. Amen. You can take a seat.
It's good to see you. Wow. It's good to see all of you here and across six campuses. I don't see all the campuses, but you guys see me, wherever you are. And I'm glad to be with you this morning. The frozen people, the faithful few who braved it out, right? In the snowstorm, and some of you watching online did not have the bravery, but you're brave enough to watch. That's good. I am glad to be with you. It was good to see Andy. Andy and I traipsed around Israel together about 10 years ago, and we had a great time, and I understand that the elders have just approved in 2022, Dr. Mike Van Lanningham, my good friend, one of the finest people I know, will be leading a tour to Israel. I'll be coming along too to help out. And we're looking forward to that day when there won't be a pandemic and people will be able to travel. And hopefully many of you will join us in Israel. I'm really, really excited about that. And it just was approved, if you can imagine that. So How many of you have ever listened to Open Line or know me from that? Two of you, I see them, that's good. No, there's a few more than that, but not that many. Saturday mornings, 9 to 11, I answer Bible questions, and it's a lot of fun. How many of you have a Moody Bible commentary? Dr. Mike Van Landing and I edited that together. That's great. I hope you find that helpful. It's something that was a labor of love. I'll just give you a clue about Mike Van Landingham. He used to say to me, it took us about 6-7 years to do, he'd call me up and say, will this ever be finished? And so he has his own ringtone on my phone. It's the music from Mission Impossible. Well, I do want to say I'm happy to be with you. I haven't preached much in the last year. This is only the second message I'm doing in a year with people. So that's a big deal for me. And so I'm glad to be back and be with you. I love this church and I care about you so much, and I'm really glad to be here. Now, this year's been disappointing, but we Chicagoans, right? I'm a honorary Chicagoan. I've lived here for almost 30 years. I'm actually a New Yorker. But we Chicagoans are familiar with disappointment, are we not? I mean, we have the Cubs. And now the Bears, too. I mean, really. If ever there was a city that understands disappointment, it's the city of Chicago. And they finally win the pennant a couple years ago, and immediately they go back to being terrible. I mean, they win the pennant for the first time since Pearl Harbor, and then they go back to. So we understand disappointment, but that's disappointment with sports, and it's really not that important. It's disappointment in life that really gets us. I have a friend, this is a true story. He was just finished his residency, he's a physician, he got hired by a practice to be a physician there. And what he found out is every year they would hire someone for a year to be an associate in that practice. And then when they had to pay more, they would release whoever it was. So he thought he was getting a job. And at 1 year, he found out he was being let go and losing his insurance. That same week, he found out that his 5-year-old son had a brain tumor. And his younger boy had cerebral palsy. And his wife called me and she said, "Does God hate us? Does God hate us?" That's the sense of disappointment with God that I want to talk about. I think it's possible for any of us or all of us at some time in our life to feel disappointed with God, to feel abandoned by God. It might be a young athlete who has a car wreck and is reduced to a wheelchair, or it might be a wife checking her phone's unusual cell phone usage and find that he is having an affair when she looks at his phone. It might be a child that a person raised with such care and love, then throwing everything off, throwing their faith off, messing around with drugs, going around with the wrong crowd and thinking, "God, I did what I was supposed to do. What has happened here?" I've talked to people who take their retirement, they're so excited to finally do some traveling, and then their spouse has cancer and the whole plan goes up in smoke. There are so many times where we look up and say, "God, do you hate me? I am so disappointed with how things have turned out." Life's been hard in the pandemic here. People are disappointed about that. I have students who have lost parents. They're disappointed. The whole situation that people have faced with congregations, they are disappointed. Where are you, God? How should we feel? How should we react when we face disappointment like this? I think the answer is in the book of Ruth, and that's why I've chosen Ruth as the series for this month. The leadership asked, "What do you want to preach?" And I said, "I want to preach on finding hope in a disappointing world, because the world has become disappointing. Our circumstances have become disappointing. And the answer to finding hope in a disappointing world is found in the Word of God in the Book of Ruth. And so if you have a Bible, I hope you'll take it out. Of course, some of you might take out your phone and read the Bible there, but I prefer paper and ink, so I just really want to encourage you to get a Bible, not a phone, but that's okay. And we're going to look at the Book of Ruth. And I want to begin just by reading the opening verses of this, the beginning part of the book. So we'll just read the text, follow along. Ruth 1, during the time of the judges, there was a famine in the land. A man left Bethlehem in Judah with his wife and two sons to live in the land of Moab for a while. The man's name was Elimelech, and his wife's name was Naomi. The names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephratites from Bethlehem in Judah. They entered the land of Moab and settled there. Naomi's husband Elimelech died, and she was left with her two sons. Her sons took Moabite women as their wives. One was named Orpah, not Oprah, everyone, Orpah. And the second was named Ruth. After they lived in Moab about 10 years, both Mahlon and Chilion also died. And Naomi was left without her two children and without her husband. She and her daughters-in-law prepared to leave the land of Moab because she had heard in Moab that the Lord had paid attention to his people's need by providing them food. She left the place where she had been living, accompanied by her two daughters-in-law, and traveled along the road leading back to the land of Judah. She said to them, "Each of you go back to your mother's home. May the Lord show faithful love to you as you have shown to the dead and to me. May the Lord enable each of you to find security in the house of your new husband." She kissed them, and they wept loudly. "No," they said to her, "we will go with you to your people." But Naomi replied, "Return home, my daughters. Why do you want to go with me? Am I able to have any more sons who could become your husbands? Return home, my daughters, go on, for I am too old to have another husband. Even if I thought there was still hope for me to have a husband tonight and to bear sons, would you be willing to wait for them to grow up? Would you restrain yourselves from remarrying? No, my daughters, my life is much too bitter for you to share, because the Lord's hand has turned against me." Again, they wept loudly. Orpah kissed her mother-in-law and took Ruth, but Ruth clung to her. That's the setup. That is the setting of the story. It starts with a famine. In verse 1, it says, in the time of the judges, there was a famine in the land. Now, what does a famine represent? There's two possibilities about a famine. Perhaps a famine was a sign of God's discipline. And the reason I say that, in the time of Gideon, it talks about how the Midianites came and burned up all the crops as a sign of discipline in the book of Judges. When people forgot God, he brought an enemy like the Midianites on them, and they burned the crops, and the people were not able to eat. So perhaps that was the sign. It was a sign of God's discipline. Another possibility is in the book of Deuteronomy, it says when the people abandoned God, he would withhold rain, and there would be a famine. It says in Deuteronomy 11, the Lord's anger will burn against you if you turn away, and he will shut up the heavens so that it will not rain and the ground will produce no produce. So that perhaps was the cause of the famine. It was either God's discipline through the Midianites or perhaps God's displeasure by withholding rain. The reaction that you see is with found in verses 1 and 2, Elimelech intended to go to Moab. Basically, what he intended to do was, it says he went there. The Hebrew reflects he went there. It was supposed to be a temporary stay. But once he got there, they had a long sojourn. In fact, it says it was 10 years. Nobody ever decides to go disobey God.
They were not supposed to have anything to do with Moabites. No one ever says, yeah, I'm going to disobey. Well, maybe some people do, but most people, when we disobey God, we say, you know, I'm just going to do it this one time or for just a little while till I get out of the bad circumstances I'm in. And then what happens? It becomes habited. And it becomes a long time. And that's what happens here with Elimelech. He takes his family there. It's going to be a short stay till the food's available. And then they stay and they stay and the sons marry and it becomes a long sojourn. What we see is the consequences of this story is, of course, first there's the death of Elimelech. Naomi's husband dies. And then these two boys, Mahlon and Chilion, marry the two Moabite women. And this ends up with the death of both sons. So Naomi has lost her husband and both her sons. How heartbreaking. And these two young women have lost their husbands. And the circumstances that you find yourself in this little section that we've just read is that for Naomi, she is an elderly widow. She is facing elderly widowhood. There's no hope for her. She's alone in a foreign land. To be a widow gave you no rights, gave you no protection in a foreign land. For Ruth and Orpah, they were facing childless widowhood. They had no hope as well. And that kind of is the setting of where we come to when we look at this first chapter of Ruth. And here's where we find the principle. The thing that I want you to look at is that the responses that the characters in this passage have to disappointment with God, our response to disappointment will determine our walk with God. However we respond to the disappointing circumstances will affect how it is that we continue in our progress, in our walk with God. That's what we see with these characters. And I want to look at each of them and see, as we go through them, with whom do we each identify? What do we do when we face disappointment? Okay? So first of all, like Elimelech, we can respond to disappointment with disobedience. He was terribly disappointed with the famine in the land. And so what we have is the man of Elimelech, married to Naomi, they went and they entered the land of Moab. Let's understand Moab. The people of Moab came about because there was an ancestral relationship between Lot, Abraham's nephew, and his two daughters. And from that, those incestuous relationships, the people of Moab and the people of Ammon came to be. Then in Numbers 25, Israel played the harlot with people from Moab. They actually strayed from God in their faith in God and became idolaters, even in the wilderness wanderings. And not only that, but they began to have immoral relationships with Moabite women and Midianite women. And so when we get to the end of the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 23, Israel was commanded not to have anything to do with Moab. So if there's a famine in the land, I think the best thing to do is stay in the land and let God provide. But go to Egypt if you got to go someplace. But not to Moab. But Moab, if you want to, did we see the map yet? I have to remember. Can we look at the map? There we go. You can look at the map and you can see where Moab is. Let's see if we can, do you see that? It's over there, northeast of the Dead Sea. It's a barren place, but apparently they had food. So that's where they went. And it was fairly close to Judea, where they were from. So they just made the trek right over there. It wasn't as far as Egypt. And that's where they went. So they went to the place that was forbidden. And he justifies, it's only going to be a short while. You could just hear it. And then they ended up staying a long time. Elimelech was disobedient. And truthfully, when we feel disappointed with God, some of us will just decide to abandon God, to disobey God, to do whatever we want. How many times have I talked to people who are in a cold and difficult marriage, and what do? They find warmth and love outside of that marriage and disobey what God says. Instead of repairing and working to help that marriage, they give up. They say, I'm disappointed with you. This is not what I expected when I said I do. I'm going to find my love, my care outside the bonds of marriage. That's what people do. A business turns sour. We're not doing so well. There's pressure because of the pandemic. And so we start cutting some corners and making some ethical lapses. We know God doesn't approve of that, but hey, he's the one that put me in this circumstance to start with. People sometimes justify our disobedience because we think God started it. He's the one that disappointed us. It always starts with a small compromise, and then it leads to outright rebellion. That's what Elimelech did. I'm going to go for a little while. Then he stayed. So like Elimelech, we can respond with disobedience. Like Naomi, on the other hand, we can respond with despair. Naomi despaired of God's goodness. We read in verse 13 already that she says, the Lord's hand has turned against me. But she goes on later in the chapter, in verse 20 and verse 21, here's what she says, don't call me Naomi, which means sweet, lovely. Don't call me sweet. Call me Mara. Call me bitter. For the Almighty has made me very bitter. I went away full, but the Lord brought me back empty. Why do you call me Naomi, since the Lord has pronounced judgment on me and the Almighty has afflicted me? I want to be really clear. I think Naomi really knew the Lord. She loved the Lord. She was just obeying her husband by going to Moab. But she is now at a point, and the reason I say I think she knows the Lord, if you look through the whole book of Ruth, you'll find that that she talks about the Lord quite a bit. Even in this chapter, she talks about the Lord quite a bit. She is God-focused, but she is terribly disappointed, and she despairs of God's goodness and of God's kindness. She despairs that she'll ever sense his warmth and his love and his grace again. She doesn't know what happened, but she has lost hope. And she despairs of God's goodness. She doesn't think she'll ever experience it again. You know, many of us would have a hard time denying the faith. We know the truth of God's existence. We know the truth of the resurrection. We're certain of it. We're certain that Jesus died for us and rose again, and he's our only Savior. But we may come to the point in a disappointing circumstance where we despair of his goodness to us, of his kindness and his warmth and his love, a sense of who he is and present in our life. I knew a lovely woman in Israel many, many years ago. She was a really faithful believer, but very tough in that land to find a believer to marry. And as she got older, she became to feel like God had embittered her a little bit because there was no one for her to marry because she was faithful. And then her brother was hit by a bus and killed. And she still taught Sunday school, or Shabbat school as we called it. She still was involved in her congregation. And she still was obedient. But she had lost any sense of abundant life. She had lost a sense of joy. she despaired of God's goodness. I can understand her. And that's a choice that some of us make. And it's not really a choice. It's just something we fall into when we see that things are just going not a way that we thought. We forget sometimes that God is using these circumstances ultimately to bring a greater redemption. But nevertheless, that's what happens. Like Naomi, we can respond with despair. Third, like Orpah, we can respond to the adversities and difficulties and disappointments of life with desertion. You know, Naomi told both her daughters-in-law to go back. But it says in verses 14 and 15 that Orpah kissed her mother-in-law and went back. Naomi said to Ruth, "Your sister-in-law has gone back to her people." And here's the key phrase I want you to see. "And to her God." Follow your sister-in-law. Naomi likely had brought these two young women to a faith in the God of Israel. And what we see here is that Orpah says, "No, I think I'll go back to Moloch. I'll go back to that false god. I'll go back to my family. I'll find a husband there." And she deserts her faith in God, not just her mother-in-law. She deserts her walk with the Lord. Sometimes when we feel abandoned by God, we just throw up our arms and say, "That's it, I'm done with you, God. I don't believe any of this." And we apostatize. Now, that raises the question, did that person really know the Lord, the person who makes that decision? If you are one of those people, if any of us are one of those people thinking about, "Yeah, I think I'm going to just give this up," ask yourself, "Do I really know Jesus? Have I really put my trust in him? Do I know that he died for me because he loves me so much and he was raised again and he can get me through this?" If we choose desertion, I don't think it means that we've lost anything. It means we never had anything. It says in 1 John, that they went out from us, but they did not really belong to us. For if they had belonged to us, to the community of faith, they would have remained with us. But their going showed that none of them belonged to us. When people choose desertion, it's because they really never, ever came to a full knowledge, a true knowledge of the Lord Jesus. So I have dealt with people who, when everything's going great, they are in the community and they're all so zealous. And then pressure, disowned by family, or loss of a loved one, or any number of things. And they say, "You know what? I expected more of God. I expected better. I expected a joyride with Jesus where everything was going to be great." And they abandon. I don't think they really lost their salvation. I think a person who understood Jesus just couldn't do that. It would be like the disciples. Do you remember them? When everyone left Jesus after the bread of life discourse in John 6, and Jesus says, "Where are you guys going to go to?" And what did the disciples say? "To whom shall we go? You alone have the words of eternal life." I love how Mike V always talks about, "Where are you going to go? Where are you going to go? This is the only place." But some people do choose desertion. Let me just encourage you, if you are at that place, if you are thinking, maybe I just give up this whole faith, I plead with you, where are you going to go? Only to Jesus. Only to him. He alone has the words of eternal life. He alone. And if that convinces you, then you knew him. And if you are saying, "No, I still want to leave," then I beg you, put your trust in him. Decide for him to follow him, because it will never, in the end, be disappointing. Might be disappointing at times now, but in the end, for eternity, we will be satisfied. Here's a fourth way that we can respond to disappointment. Like Ruth, we can respond with determination. After Naomi tells Ruth to leave, "Go back like your sister," your sister-in-law. Ruth replied in verses 16 through 18, "Do not persuade me to leave you or go back and not follow you. For wherever you go, I will go. And wherever you live, I will live. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord punish me and do so severely if anything but death separates you and me." When Naomi saw, and here's the key, that Ruth was determined to go with her, she stopped trying to persuade her. Ruth had spiritual determination. She was completely sold, and there was just no way she was going back to Moab. No way she was going to go back to Malach. No way she was going to leave Naomi. What spiritual determination. Now, I know a lot of people read this at weddings, right? It's not really about marriage, but it is about relationship. Ruth's relationship with the Lord affected her relationship with Naomi. The vertical affected the horizontal. You see, she was devoted to the Lord and therefore devoted to his people and devoted to Naomi. I think that's just phenomenal when we think about it. She knew that false gods wouldn't help. She knew that God delivered Israel from Egypt and he would deliver them again. She was determined. We need that same kind of determination. When we face disappointment, to stay faithful in our walk, we need to be determined to be faithful to the Lord. And let me say why. When bad stuff happens, and we're disappointed and hurt, and we're facing adversity, and we feel abandoned by God, when we determine to be faithful, that's when God does extraordinary things. That's when God works. That's when he transforms us. That is the key, to be faithful, to be determined to be faithful. When we pray, even if we wonder when God hears. When we listen to his word, when we think we can't even hear him. When we praise him, even when we don't understand him. When we worship him, when we feel that we've been treated as worthless. When we obey him, even when we think he isn't watching us anymore. I think this is a really important spiritual point. There's a book called The Screwtape Letters, and C.S. Lewis wrote something in there. Have you ever read the Screwtape Letters? Screwtape is a series of letters from a chief tempter to his nephew, Wormwood, who's tempting a new Christian, a new follower of Jesus. And so he tells him that he's going, he says, so you think that this low spot, this valley he's going through, this trough is a good thing. He says, it's not a good thing. And he says that there's this law of undulation, the closest thing, he tells this junior tempter, the closest thing that a believer can come to in terms of being steady is undulating between peaks and valleys, going from top to bottom, from highs to lows. We never really stay on that steady flow. And God, when a believer first comes to faith, he writes, God's so visibly present. Prayers are answered. There's a sensory feeling that God is there. And then he doesn't really step away, but he makes us not sense that we're there. That's what Wormwood writes. Uncle Screwtape writes. To see if we'll just keep walking, to keep going with him. And he says, that is when our enemy, that's what he calls the Lord, that's when our enemy really has someone. That's when he can really use him. When they stay faithful, regardless of how they feel. Here's what he says. Our cause is never more in danger, Wormwood. When a human, no longer desiring but still intending to do our enemy's will, looks around upon a universe from which every trace of him seems to have vanished and asks, why has he been forsaken? And still obeys. And still obeys. That's the kind of follower Ruth was. Determined to obey. And that's the kind of follower we need to be. Follower of the Lord Jesus. Determined to obey him. Look, we've looked at this chapter. It's remarkable because it shows that how we respond to disappointment will determine our walk with God. We can be disobedient and ultimately experience God's judgment, discipline, like Elimelech. We can despair and enter into a superficial zombie state in our walk, just going through the motions. We can defect and desert and lose all semblance of true faith and then show that we really don't know him. Or, like Ruth, we can determine to be faithful. And when we determine to be faithful, we'll grow and ultimately experience the greatest redemption, the most marvelous deliverance that we've ever anticipated, more than we've ever anticipated. Can we hold on? Can we be determined? Who should we be determined to be faithful to? I want to suggest a couple of things here. When we determine to be faithful, who should we be determined to be faithful to? First of all, I think we have to determine to be faithful to our spiritual mentors. I just want to say this, that I experienced a time about 20 years ago, a little bit more, when I despaired of the Lord's goodness in the land of the living. Ministry was horrible and circumstances were awful. And I just despaired of God's goodness. And I didn't know if I didn't want to stay in the ministry. I didn't want to do anything like that. Let me just say this. God brought many people in to encourage me, but the most amazing was that I had a few students who I had mentored. And they were the ones that prayed for me and encouraged me and were determined to be faithful to me, just like Ruth was with Naomi. If you see someone who has been influential in your walk with the Lord, who's helped you grow, helped you learn, and they are struggling and despairing of God's goodness, determined to be faithful like Ruth was to Naomi. Be faithful and encourage and strengthen that person. Second, we must determine to be faithful to the Lord's people. What do we want to do when we despair? We want to quit going to congregation. We want to quit being involved with other of God's people, right? Not Ruth. What did she say? Your people will be my people. I'm going to stick with you, Naomi, and I'm going to stick with the people of Israel. That's where the God of Israel is. That's where the true faith is. Your people will be my people. We need to be faithful to God's people. Even if it's on Zoom, be in services. Even if it's small group meeting online, be in small group. We need to be determined to be faithful to God's people. Third, determined to be faithful to the Lord himself. When the last thing in the world we want to do is open the word in the morning, that's when we read it. When the last thing in the world we want to do is spend some time talking to him, that's when we're determined to do it. When the last thing we want to do is come and worship, let's worship because he's worthy. It takes determination, just like Ruth. Can we hang on? Can we be determined? It would be the best thing for us. A number of years ago, I read this story, actually in the newspaper. It was 2007 or so. And it said that Joe Thompson II got a phone call that said his teenage son had been in a car accident and was hanging on for dear life. He thought he was dying, but he wasn't. He was literally hanging on for dear life. You see, what had happened, his Jeep had been hit through him from the top of his Wrangler, and he went flying in the air and caught a hold of electrical wires. And he was just hanging on to these electrical wires, and they were waiting for the emergency vehicles to get there. This happened in Blue Springs, Missouri. And he dangled there by those wires for 20 minutes. He was hugging those wires. And then the rescue crew came, and they were going to bring him down by ladder. And what the crew shouted up to him, "Are you able to hang on?" And he said, "Yes." And they said, "For how long?" He says, "As long as it takes. As long as it takes." Listen, it's a disappointing world we're living in, and there's disappointing circumstances. Are we determined to be faithful? Can we hang on? How long can we hang on? Tell me. As long as it takes. As long as it takes. And we will see God's goodness in the land of the living. Can we pray? Father, thank you for your good word and its good reminder that you are faithful to us even when we don't see it. So, Lord, we commit now to be faithful to our Lord Jesus and follow him wherever he goes. In his name we pray. Amen.
Thank God for the faithful proclamation of his word through Dr. Rydelnik today. Hey, no need to rush away. We can pray for you or with you today. Click on the live prayer or through a link in the comments. We love to care for you today. We want to invite you back next Sunday morning at 9 and 11 Central Time. And if you live in the Chicagoland area, you're welcome to join us in person at one of our 6 campuses. Harvest, go into this week with this truth stamped on your life. You are loved.